celebrate the sixth Sunday in ordinary time. Under the leadership of the Capuchin Franciscan Friars and in union with the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Philadelphia, St. John's welcomes all who present with us, who are present with us today in praising God and serving God's people. In this Eucharist, we remember especially the intention of our celebrant, Father Abbey. As we are about to begin the liturgy, please turn off or silence all paging devices, cell phones, or any other devices that may be a cause of disruption or distraction. Thank you.
Please rise and join me in singing number 488 in your copy of Breaking Bread, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Number 488, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Together we begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Dear brothers and sisters, as we prepare ourselves to celebrate this wonderful mystery, let's call to mind our sins and ask the pardon of the Lord. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who teach us that you abide in hearts that are just and true, grant that we may be so fashioned by your grace as to become a dwelling pleasing to you. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. Thus says the Lord, cursed is the one who trusts in human beings, who seeks his strength in flesh, whose heart turns away from the Lord. He is like a barren bush in the desert that enjoys no change of season, but stands in a lava waste, a salt, an empty earth. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who hopes in the Lord. He is like a tree planted beside the waters that stretches out its roots to the stream. It fears not the heat when it comes. Its leaves stay green. In the year of drought, it shows no distress, but still bears fruit. The word of the Lord. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, if Christ is preached as raised from the dead, how can some among you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If the dead are not raised, neither has Christ been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is vain. You are still in your sins. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If for this life only we have hoped in Christ, we are the most pitiable people of all. But now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. The word of the Lord.
Amen. Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. Jesus came down with the 12 and stood on a stretch of a level ground. With a great crowd of his disciples and a large number of the people from all Judea and Jerusalem and the coastal region of Tyre and Sidon. And raising his eyes toward his disciples, he said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for the kingdom of God is yours. Blessed are you who are now hungry, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who are now weeping, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude and insult you, and denounce your name as evil on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice and leap for joy on that day. Behold, your reward will be great in heaven. For their ancestors treated the prophets in the same way. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are filled now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will grieve and weep. Woe to you who all speak well of you, when all speak well of you, for their ancestors treated the false prophets in the same way." The Gospel of the Lord. Dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, as we have just heard in the Gospel, it's all about beatitudes. But they are not the beatitudes that we are used to hear from the Gospel of St. Matthew. There are only four beatitudes which is being mentioned in the Gospel of St. Luke, and followed by that four woes, which is not there in Matthew. So four beatitudes, and followed by that, four woes. So in the Gospel of St. Luke, instead of "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven," we hear, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." Luke is telling those who are poor, hungry, weeping, hated, excluded, insulted, and denounced, that they are blessed. That's what Luke says. And he's telling to those who are not suffering, those who are rich, those who are filled with food, those who are laughing and treated with respect, that they are going to suffer. What are we to make of this? Is it good to be poor? If I really ask someone on the street, "Is it good to be poor?" I'm sure I'm not going to get a good response from him or her. If I ask someone who has no home or a shelter, if I ask them, "Is it very good to be poor like you, or not having a shelter?" I think the answer will be the same. So what does it mean when Jesus says, "Blessed are you who are poor"? Should we, like St. Francis of Assisi, throw away all our possessions and become beggars? Is it what Jesus tells us? Well, this is all about our hearts, the attitude in life that we should have. This is not about material possessions. This is not about material possession. We should not be thinking so narrowly. We should be thinking with God. We should be thinking with Jesus, what exactly he was trying to say. It really has a lot to do with us and our present situation in the society. We need to be open to God to let him into our lives. Let him into our lives. If we make room for God, we will have room for others. That's exactly what we need to think. It's not about material possessions that we are having. It's not about a big house that we are having. It's not about a bank account we are having. But what is it all about is our attitude towards God and our neighbors. That's exactly what Jesus is mentioning through these Beatitudes from the Gospel of St. Luke. We need to be open to God to let him into our lives. How can we open to God? That's another question that we need to ask ourselves. How can I open to God? We have so much else in our minds. So many of us, including me, we are glued sometimes to our devices. Think about a mobile phone, just for an example. Even, I'm sure, the first thing most of us will be checking when we get out of this church will be our mobile phones, thinking that someone must have called us, some text messages would be there, or something important is happening. So the important thing that we look for will be our mobile phones. I'm not criticizing anyone, including me, we do the same thing. We are so much glued to these devices. I don't tell this as something wrong, but the problem could be we are so much attached or addicted to that, it takes our time and our space away from God. Most of us make the complaint that we don't have time for prayer. I have made that complaint. I don't have time for prayer. I'm a religious priest. I'm a religious friar. I have made that complaint. Can you imagine? That I don't have time. Today I did not get time. You know, kind of a lame complaint to my God. I'm sorry, I did not get my time to spend with you some time yesterday. I'm sorry. But I did have time to spend with my mobile phone, with my devices. Most of us makes that complaint, but it's a baseless complaint, because how does that complaint come? We have spent or overspent some time with our devices, which have taken away the time and space for my God. And that's how exactly we lose time. So that's something that we need to check. Blessed are we when we are with God. Blessed are we when you spend time with God. When you invite God to your life. So that's the first and important step. Give a room for God in your lives. So naturally, if you give room for God, then you are giving time for your brothers and sisters. If you give room for God, if you give time for God, you are giving time and room for your near and dear ones. In the Gospel of Luke, we hear about Lazarus and the rich man. In this parable, we hear Lazarus was a poor man covered with sores. He sat at the gate of that rich man, and he was starving and longed to eat just the scraps that fell from the rich man's table. And by the end of the parable, we see they both die and they go to their designated places. The rich man goes to hell, and the Lazarus goes to heaven, to Abraham's lap. That's what we hear. I always think, what was the mistake or what was the sin that rich man committed? He never here that man kicked this poor man with sores out of his gate? No. We don't see an instance wherein that man shouting at Lazarus, get out of my house or get out of my compound. We never hear that. The sin which he has committed was the sin of omission. He did not mind. Lazarus was not in his head. Lazarus was not in his heart. Lazarus was not existing. For the rich man, Lazarus was not existing. Most of us live like our brothers and sisters are not existing. Most of us live in that way, at least in moments. At least in some moments we live like my neighbors are not existing, my brothers and sisters are not existing, my parents are not existing, my children are not existing. Because we don't seriously look into their lives. They are not a serious concern for me. That's where we commit the sin of omission. That's where we exclude anyone who is apart from me. Then, woe to you. Woe to you. Because you are enjoying whatever you have, but you are not considering your God and your brothers and sisters. You are rich, but if you consider God and your brothers and sisters, blessed are you. If you are rich, if you are enjoying, if you are accepted by everyone, and don't consider your brothers and sisters and don't give room for God, woe to you. Even if you are poor, you are suffering, even amidst that, if you are not considering your God and your neighbors, woe to you. The brothers and sisters, we cannot reach out to others if we are all wrapped up in ourselves. Sometimes we think that it's me and my world. Who are you? I think it was Sartre, the philosopher, who was so much worried and so much concerned about the others and their stare, and then they called, and he called, the other is a hell. The other is a hell. We live in such a society. I'm not joking. We live in such a society wherein sometimes we consider other is a hell. But it was Immanuel Levinas who came and corrected Sartre, telling that other is not a hell. It is through him that I realize the absolute. So dear brothers and sisters, we need everyone. We need God. We need our brothers and sisters. We need our life partners. We need our children. We need everyone to reach God. It's not a one-man journey. It's not a one-man show in our lives. Let's move with God, with our brothers and sisters. Then we will hear the words of God reverberating on our ears. Blessed are you. Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made,
consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the Beatitudes, we hear that Jesus promised God's blessings upon those who are poor, hungry, weeping, excluded, or insulted. Therefore, we call upon our Heavenly Father with our prayers for all those in need.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. For the church, that we may be a beacon to the world of charity and mercy through the good that we do, in faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the Holy Spirit will inspire world leaders as they seek a diplomatic solution to the growing threat to the invasion of Ukraine, in faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may never close our hearts to those in need, but consciously involve ourselves in Christ's work of healing and reconciliation. In faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those burdened with poverty, sickness, or loneliness, may God comfort them and provide what they need to heal and prosper. In faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, parents, relatives, friends, and those who have no one to pray for them, may they share fully in the life which Christ has won for us through his death and his resurrection. In faith we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions in our book of prayer and those that each of us offers now in silence. And for the intentions of our priest here, Father Abbey.
God of comfort and hope, you look with mercy upon those whom the world has beaten down. Help us to spread your mercy and compassion among those we encounter in our lives. Hear our prayers we make today and grant them through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.
Please join me in singing our offertory hymn number 483, Christians, Let Us Love One Another. Number 483, Christians, Let Us Love One Another.
Christians, let us love one another. As we share this truth, living bread.
my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be made acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of the man, with praise and glory of his name, for our good and for all of his holy church.
May this oblation, O Lord, we pray, cleanse and renew us, and may it become for those who do your will the source of eternal reward. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing. He gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth. With your servant, Francis our Pope, Nelson our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own, listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom, where we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
The Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us all trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Let's offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
Lord, I'm not worthy to enter into my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
Please join me in our communion hymn number 478, Endless is Your Love. Number 478, Endless is Your Love.
us pray. Having fed upon these heavenly delights, we pray, O Lord, that we may always long for that food by which we truly live. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Brothers and sisters, I would love to thank TJ and Annette for helping us with the liturgy. May Almighty God bless us, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. This Mass is ended. Let's go and love the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in singing our recessional hymn number 598, Christ Be Our Light.